First, you guys, like to thank you guys for coming out. And Cody, I want to thank you for hosting me. It's been great. This is a little bit of the big time. Tomorrow they have R.L. Stein. So that guy is like huge. Yeah, he's going to be right where we are. So that's, yeah. Oh, that was strong. But still good. All good. But anyway, this is like the last book in my Messier Poet series, the Skyscraper Shuffle. And the Messier Poet series was a idea I came up with to write messenger stories in verse, in poetry. So the first book was called Messier Poet. The other book was Bart in New York. And this is the final one in the Skyscraper Shuffle. And those other two books were like, they were kind of fun, but it had some hard stuff in it. You know, I try to write about the drama that messengers go through. I try to write about the edgy competitiveness that messengers like to get into, like who's the fastest in the city is a big issue. And I love writing about that. But in this one, I kind of like wanted to write about what it's like to work in the Big Apple among skyscrapers. There's a lot of them. And us messengers have a unique experience that we get a chance to visit a lot of them. And so I made that kind of like the theme of this particular book. And so for National Poetry Month, It's just a great honor to be able to read from it during that great month where poets all over the country are reading their work. So I brought a few of my friends to kind of talk about the Messier life. So the verse is good, it's fun, but it doesn't take you really deep into it. So these cats behind me, they know their stuff. So you guys are really in for a treat. So I'm gonna read a bunch of poems from the book. It's not going to be many. And then I'm going to give the floor to my guys and then moderate the action. So the first one I'm going to read, it's appropriate because it deals with skyscrapers. This is called The New High Rise. The New High Rise. Crossing the city streets on the east side and on the west side. Skyscrapers all around me. I am the fastest messenger, you see. Luxury living in the sky, the new high-rise. With doormen and coattail, top hats and white gloves to greet you every day. Remember the courier's name. $1 billion over here and $1 billion over there. My neighbor has $1 billion and so do I. How do I know? I am the delivery guy. Rushing down the city streets on bicycle and by foot. The package gets delivered on time. 432 Park Avenue, the new high-rise. Luxury living in the sky. Okay. Thank you, guys. This one I wrote about last year, two police officers were murdered, and they became heroes of the city. And this poem I wrote about them. Heroes of the city. I cry because police officers keep us alive. The bad guy versus the good guys. Of course, we know police brutality as we know America's Civil War. The rights to bear arms, but getting shot because you're black is wrong. Not to confuse you here. Giuliani, Mayor DiBaggio, President Obama, Commissioner Bratton, I live in the finest city in the world, rich and poor alike. New York City is the greatest, all right. Rest in peace, my brothers, Wen Jiang Liu and Rafael Ramirez. You are heroes of the city. And since it's baseball season, I'll give you a little verse about baseball. Okay, this is called Opening Day, Yankee Stadium. On the rush for mobile messenger service, I start thinking about the new Yankee Stadium as I can see it now. home runs, base hits, walks, balls and strikes, hot dogs, peanuts, and Cracker Jacks. The house that Ruth and Jeter built, the new Yankee Stadium. I can see it now. Home runs, base hits, walks, balls and strikes, hot dogs, peanuts, and Cracker Jacks. Opening day, Yankee Stadium. Okay, you guys. All right, so these guys in the back, you know, they're great, and I'm gonna try to make it simple, and make the discussion feel kind of lively and let it flow, and I'll kind of like want you guys to like listen in, and if you hear something you like and you want to jump in, just kind of like wave your hand or say something, you know, you want to get in, and you know, we're just going to keep it like fun and, you know, keep it messenger style, you know. So Ben Stewart, he's been in a messenger for a little while, but now he's a professor at NYU, assistant professor. So I want Ben, tell us a little bit about, you know, your messenger experience, but also talk about your thesis that you wrote about messengers.
So I wrote a dissertation about messenger culture, mostly messenger culture in the 90s and early 2000s. One of the main things I was interested in was the ways that the international messenger culture affected the local communities. Instead of going from the local to the global, it was like people were going to these international events and seeing this community there. And like, I know, Hodari, you had this experience of going to San Francisco and be like, oh my God, there's this
eye-opener.
International community that has these networks and is able to do all these things.
And I haven't paid for a hotel room since.
So there's these informal networks that enable this kinds of global travel, but also community ideals that people brought back to the local communities to organize them. And that's a large part of, even though New York was very influential in the early days, I mean, the track bike phenomenon basically started here from Caribbean immigrants bringing track bikes to the city. And so that object spread out from here, although New York was a very fragmented community otherwise. Like in the 80s, there was a very strong community around like Washington Square Park, but the police then broke that up. And so New York's messenger community didn't really come together until people like Hodari started going to the Messenger World Championships in San Francisco and Zurich and Budapest and, you know, saw the communities that were forming at the international level and then brought that spirit back to organize the community here, some of which we see on display here. Like Monster Track was definitely part of the legacy of that international community that brought the Alley Cat back to New York City. And so those community dynamics were basically the focus of my dissertation.
Okay, great. Next is going to be Cordell. Cordell has a very interesting project, and it's, from what I understand, it's called the Messenger Study?
Yeah.
Okay, so tell us what the Messenger Study is.
Well, what the Messenger Study is I myself, and I'm an independent photojournalist, and I make it my life to research other people's lives. And I've been a messenger myself, like off and on. I've done food delivery, I've done messenger work for about, like I say, 3 or 4 years now. And along the way, it's a kind of independent job where it's not like a job you go to school for and you learn the trade and you apply to see if you get hired. It's kind of like you just need the money and you find the opportunity, you just get the job and you just start working. And the job is not based on what you know, it's more based on what you can do, you know, what you're capable of. So I was capable of riding my bike and getting paid to ride my bike, basically. That's what I called it when I started. And I learned a lot, I met a lot of good people. And along the way, I started adding my love for photojournalism into my lifestyle with the people that I met. So I started doing this thing called the Messenger Study, where I studied messengers by trying to tell their story, by understanding who they are, by taking a photo of them and their lives and like their objects that they carry to get the job done. Because my life as a messenger, I've learned that like, you're capable of doing things based on the equipment you carry. Like, most jobs, you get hired to do a job, or you get called to do a job, and you get asked by your dispatcher, can you pick up a mattress, you know? And you know you can because of the large bag you brought to work today and all the straps. If you know you can't, then you deny it, you know? But if you know you can, you can. And then when you can, you're ready.
They don't provide it for you.
Yeah, they don't provide it for you. You just have to be capable. You say, yeah, I got that, and I got three others too, you know? So then you pick it up, boom, now you got a mattress on your back. Now you're getting paid, you know? All because you're capable. And I've just met a lot of dudes that just have a lot of equipment, and they really are just so independent with how they take care of themselves and how they take care of their money. And my study is about them. And
before we get to that, you on your Instagram, you have a little bit about staying alive. So is the messenger job dangerous per se?
Yeah.
I mean, when I and I'll be honest with you, I've been a messenger like over 18 years, right? And you know, I'm a walker, and I see how the owners kind of treat the bikers, and I always thought like, okay, well, if it's really that dangerous, you know, maybe there would be an extra incentive or there would be more money, but it don't seem to be that way. So I looked at it, you know, and you can maybe correct me on this, that maybe they treat it like a paperboy route,
yeah.
Right? I give you five packages,
yeah.
And you go to these five buildings you drop off. No, like, pressure to do it in 5 minutes, 10 minutes.
Yeah.
No pressure to run a red light. So what is the staying alive part?
Well, with my photojournalism, sometimes I like to detach myself from my project. So the way I've done that is I've created a platform, kind of like a brand called Stay Alive New York, that represents my photos and other people's platforms, that just represents, like, just working hard to keep yourself alive, you know?
Can I add something to that?
Yeah.
With us as messengers, like he's saying, like individuals, you know what I mean? You're on your bike alone all day. You know what I mean? You're a lone wolf all day, but there's a wolf pack somewhere. Like, we all work for the same company, but there's a wolf pack, but it promotes that lone wolf lifestyle, and I need to be prepared for it. If I have a flat, if I do need to carry that huge bag, to have straps, have bungee cords, have inner tubes that are just used to strap on that mattress he was talking about, you know, and each individual carries certain things based upon their own, their niche. You know, like, or what they're again capable of doing.
I remember when my niche was portfolios.
The capability comes from, like, just needing the money and knowing that I need to make $100 every day for the next 7 days so I can meet that $700 threshold so that maybe on Sunday I can, you know, go to the beach, you know? But if you don't hit that mark, sometimes you're really desperate. And you're ready for anything. So the streets make you into a person that is willing to carry mattresses. Or
that's true.
Yeah, accept any job.
Even from Kurt's perspective, when he said, well, what makes you do that? Like, running red lights, there's no pressure to do that. But we don't get paid by the hour.
Yeah.
Like, when we get hired, they don't tell you, you're getting paid $12, not $10. Now you're getting paid per package.
Yeah.
So the more packages that I get, the more money I'm able to make.
Yeah, I'm
going
to tell you exactly what it is.
Okay.
A bike messenger, a good bike messenger, eat red lights. We get paid to eat red lights. Mm-hmm. So when you see a messenger pass by you and you like, I don't believe that effing messengers will just pass by me, I'm working. The smartest messenger, the best messenger who's going to make money is someone who can read, someone who can follow instructions, and someone who is fit. You cannot work 9 hours and drink 240s. And talking about you're going to come back to work tomorrow feeling fit. A lot of people drink. Bill said something about it wasn't a tight fit,
it's like
back in the 80s. I rolled in the 80s.
And, no, I think it was
and,
back in the 80s.
Right. You know what? And my man right here rolled in the 80s.
No, I rolled in the 90s. I'm class of 92, Papa.
All right. I'm a little bit older. Thank you for reminding me.
Right.
You know what? Let me tell
you
something.
Right.
Folks, there was a messenger one time who got run over in front of the cathedral.
Oh, man,
church.
I remember that.
He was laying in the sun for 4 hours. No one, not the cops, no one put a towel over that man's face. My friend put his handkerchief over the man's face. We had a demonstration. We all met at 5 o'clock. We stopped traffic for at least an hour. We rolled down to West 4. They were waiting for us at West 4. But you're not going to catch them, Effington. You're not going to catch us. Not that we don't want to. Okay? I laugh at people when they say, you know, the cop called me over and I went over to him. Let me tell you something, folks. That's an easy way to get a ticket. Okay? Now, ever since Giuliani and Mr. Bloomberg, we got to have a bike bell. We got to have this. We got to have that. We got to have a nameplate on our bike saying the name of the company we work for. Let me tell you something. You have no idea. I own a house. I'm blessed. I know a lot of other messengers that own are house owners. Good. I did not respect the street rules. Never. And my wife, who's here right now, can testify, she would not give me a baby until I got off my bike. I used to hang on to cars. I don't know what it is to stop at a red light. There would have to be a cop on a scooter right there for me to stop. Okay? And I laugh at guys when they say, I just got a ticket, man. It took me 20 minutes. He had me there, boom. You know what? All you got to do is go down the wrong way and just make sure there's traffic on that one-way street. There's no need to get a ticket. But you don't have no idea. We race against the clock. We're not racing against ourselves. We race against the clock. If you start at 9 and you want to be off at 6, you want to have 25 runs done by 6 o'clock.
Right. Can I say something, too? Like, just to you guys know, it's not just in response to being rebellious or you want to be out there doing that. Like, like he said, he does have a real life. You know, and we're just not, like, anti-police, but this guy may slow me down. And I need to, like, again, we don't get paid by the hour.
And let me tell you something.
And then that time, too.
But
when you eat a red light and you have a license, that affects your license. Like, if you just drove a car through that red light.
So my first driver's license cost me about $8,000.
Listen, folks, you have no idea what we go through.
Okay, so, Jay, I want to just stay on that. You work with a TV show, right? And the theme was, right, that you're on the clock, right? So tell me about that experience. Well, what was this TV show like? How did you feel about the production? Did you feel it was fake? What was that all about?
The TV show, I'm sad about the TV show, is Triple Rush. What I'm sad about Triple Rush is that, you know, Searching for Bigfoot is on its 7th season. And Triple Rush did not last more than 5 episodes.
Yeah.
The reason is, it was too real. People can't handle too real. It wasn't the Dailiest Catch. It wasn't nothing else. We was just too damn real. People got mad when they saw NDB, Nick. Very good guy, living in a small apartment with his mother. It looks sad and it felt sad. But you know what? Nick is a hardworking man.
Yeah.
And he provided for his mother and for his brother. And I felt very, very upset when people was attacking him on Facebook after every episode and stuff like that. That's real life. That's real life. There was no makeup about it. I'm going to tell you when it was a little bit fake, when they had me flipping on people sometimes. I will, you know, if I send you to 120, if you have 154 West 27, I gave the pickup at 27 West 24 and it takes you 20 minutes to pick it up. If you haven't called me to tell me you got hit by a bus or that you're waiting, something is wrong. If you're on 27th Street and I send you to 24th Street, you should have this like in 3 or 4 minutes. Okay? And people bug out. Listen, I get on bikers' cases because I was a biker. I feel like I was the Michael Jordan of the buses because I could read, I could follow instructions, and I'm fearless on the road. That's a hard combination. And you could depend on me. Those are the guys that are going to make money. Those are the guys that right now they have cars and they're bikers and they own houses. I'm keeping it real. I'm keeping it real. But you know what? To do that, you know how... Sometimes I wake up in a cold sweat because I just like, wow, how did that bus not kill me?
And that's the stay alive part right there.
That's the stay alive part.
That's the stay alive part.
Every time I ate a red light and came this close to getting hit, every biker here, every veteran goes like this before they start their day. Everybody.
Oh.
But you know what? Yeah. It is. And I do survive with music on. I'm not allowed to. You know, we tell our guys, don't ride with music on. I could feel You know the pulse, mm-hmm. like Kurt said, you know the pulse the of the city flow, when you're working friend. Out there. You find out things before anybody else. You find out things before anybody else. And that's what I miss about the job. I'm 50, probably near hip replacement soon. I still love my bike.
Goddamn, 50 years old, man.
I'm 50. I love my bike. But and I gotta feel like everything I have, I owe it to my bike. I really do.
Powerful. So I'm gonna switch it up a little bit. I wanna ask Chelsea a couple questions. Thank you for coming, Chelsea.
Oh, no problem. We're happy to.
Tell me how you got involved with messenger culture.
Well, I met my boyfriend about 2 years ago, and I hadn't even ridden a bike since I was like 8. And he was like, you should ride a bike. Like, I ride a bike. And I'm just like, oh, this is kind of cool. You know, I built my bike, rode up the block, hit like a pole and fell. And, you know, I was like, this is kind of great. So we would actually start taking rides downtown and, you know, with stopping downtown, you know, he would like stop to say hi to one person in the middle of the street and another person with a big bag, you know, holding something. They're like, hey, what's up? You know, how you doing? And I'm like, who are these people? I'm like, why do they all have bags? And like, I didn't really know much about the messenger culture until like, you know, I started really hanging out with everyone and really like researching online, like the OGs and, you know, all that stuff, and like how much respect I have for all these people, because it's like, wow, this is really hard. I even tried like doing messenger work for like a month, and I was like, I do not know how these people do it. It's like amazing. Like, I would catch panic attacks every like 5 seconds on my bike because I'd stop for a light, and if I didn't stop for a light, I'd almost get hit by a car. I got hit by like 4 cars like within the first year of riding, and I was like, no, these people have too much of fast reflexes. Like, you guys are amazing. And, you know, that's how I started really getting into it. And I started doing alley cats and stuff. And, you know, it's like, wow, if these people do it every single day, like an alley cat, I can't even imagine. Like,
you know
what?
It's almost like we dare the cars to hit us.
Oh, man.
You know, you ever like, eat a red light and dare? Do you see the car coming? I dare you to hit me. You see me here.
It's amazing.
I used to be on my cargo bike.
Oh,
I used to walk up and say you didn't see
me. A cargo bike. You see, I can't even imagine that. And it's like, I'm so exhausted after like alley cats and stuff. And everybody's like, oh, I gotta go, you know, back to work tomorrow and do the same exact thing I did today. And I'm like, what? Okay, this is amazing. So that's how I got like extremely involved. And I just have so much respect for everyone and love everyone. Like, it's just a big family and everyone works together. And
that's one thing about messengers. If you see a messenger get into an argument with a bike with a cab driver or something, that
we
cab driver
stop.
Is having a bad
again
bad
wolf
day.
Pack
because we are going to be a wolf pack. We may not know each other,
lone wolves,
like
lifestyle,
we will
but
all
wolf pack.
And we could even have beef with each other, but you know that's between us. And you're a cab driver, and
right.
Like me and
him
got
you know what? It's
fighting
like,
with a cabbie.
You get close to us,
I'm not
going to
go up and help the cabbie. I'm going to help
right.
Him.
You're going to help me. And you know,
we fight later.
You know what? It's like. I wonder how many windshields we have cracked. You know,
I got about
I mean,
two or
it's,
three.
It really. I say today messengers are nice. I say today messengers is nice.
For sure.
Back in the 80s, in the early 90s, like and the 70s, it was just a different breed. I mean, I try to send one of my guys up to the 80s now. They're like, what? What's 80? You know, I'm like,
up in deck, fool.
Right.
Up deck, go.
This is what we do. You know what I'm saying? So somewhere. Since I've been on the road, I feel that, I'm not going to say, because people are different, but I would have to say the majority of bikers, they dress the part, but they can't be the part. They can't really, you know.
The word's and, Posinger.
Yeah, you know what?
We're
going to
get into that.
It really is.
But let's talk
is,
about
sure.
That since we're on that, because, you know, Mosh Track was 3 weeks ago, and Hadari, I'm going to let you go on Mosh Track because you know a lot about it. The early days, right? Before we get into like, because messenger culture.
When you try to set up a union.
But messenger culture is
talk about,
a.
Let's talk about that.
Is a
no
brand.
Union. We work under no union, people.
But messenger culture is a brand. People sell it. And
this
it's worth
true.
Millions and millions of dollars. So, Chelsea, you won a race that's known, you know, worldwide. And tell me, Was that the first monster track, or you've done a number of them before?
Oh, it's my second monster track.
It's your second. Okay.
Yeah.
You won?
Yeah, I didn't win the whole entire thing, but I won first girl.
All right. Yeah. Now, that bass is really bad. It's no breaks.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Tell it. Go ahead. You tell it.
It's intense.
I mean, everyone can pretty much speak for it. No breaks, you know. You don't even know how many manifests they're throwing at you. You don't know what they're asking you to do. And, you know, it's like you're pretty much racing against 60-plus people, you know, sometimes 100, 200 from what in the past what I've heard.
It's across the city of Manhattan, sometimes into Brooklyn.
It's cold.
But like she said, you don't know where you're going.
Yeah,
it's different spots.
It's like being a messenger. When you wake up in the morning, you don't know where your first pickup is going to be.
Exactly.
And it's just like an 8-hour workday condensed to a 3-hour race, and you're going 100% the whole time.
Yeah.
Riding brakeless,
balls out,
and that's it.
That those are the rules actually too.
For this race.
Fixed gear,
balls out, no brakes.
Those are only two rules.
And that's it.
I don't like the fifth gear. I'm a mountain bike guy.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You know what? We're from another
a
time.
Different era.
They're
from a different era than where we are.
So because of your success, say now the Cats have some brands come to you for sponsorship, or if someone talk to you, say, hey, you ride a really good street style, I think you'd be a good representative of urban cycling. Has that happened
to you? Yeah, it's actually happened quite a bit of times. And, you know, it's Boone Helmets with Kevin, who's also Squid. He actually wants to do like a collab with like me. And, you know, it's a really big honor to even be a percentage of a part of what messenger culture represents and street cycling represents. And it's like, I can't accept everything that everyone's like offered to me, because I don't feel like it's my part to do it. I feel like there's so many other messengers who can take that spot.
Grab that shit out.
And in the beginning, when people started like asking me, I was a little too modest. And, you know, it's like now it's, you know, getting a little more competitive. A lot of more women and a lot more people in general just street riding and racing and, you know, getting into track bikes and getting into messenger work. And, you know, it's like a really competitive culture now. It's extremely competitive.
Yeah.
It's always been competitive, but now it's like people are throwing like extreme sponsorships, like Chanelli and, you know, even Bird. Like everyone's just throwing things at you, like represent us, like we want to show that we're badass too, like things like that.
Can I say something?
Yeah,
there was a young lady, not to call her out, she's probably walking outside, she has a chrome bag on, like a messenger style chrome bag. She just walked in here on her way out. Point her out, but
yeah.
That's how our style has influenced. Like, you guys know what chrome is? Or like those single-handed bags, like,
right.
we would use that for
I like
for
it's
necessity.
So funny that you talk about
you know,
style, because,
not just based on
when
it
I
being
came
cool.
In, when I got in the business, we used to wear
function
tights.
Over form.
We used to wear tights
and
a little
cargo
and the
cargo
and the,
shorts
and the hold on and the
fanny
the fanny pack. Right? I was like, wow. I was like, you know what? This is real crazy. You know. And I feel like me and Pistol Pete decided
that's
to wear the cargo pants.
Right?
We wore the cargo pants over the tights.
Thank you, brother,
oh,
by the way, for
first,
coming up with that.
Me and Pistol
Thank
Pete,
you.
We
yeah.
came up with it.
All right, that's
and
that's
me and Pistol Pete came up with this. We just put the cargo pants because the fanny pack
yeah, yeah,
was just...
For sure.
You know, fanny pack. That's all I have to say. And you know what? And this is the look. And I feel like Levi's make the tight pike bike pants, jeans. And more the hipsters, I'm sorry. More the hipsters. It's a more hipster look. You know, I have no problem
ain't
with that.
Chewing gums like
but,
from the 80s, bro.
That's another term.
Right.
That's another term, that hipster term. We won't have time to get into that, but so I might ask Ben about that hipster thing,
fixed
because you're the scholar. So that hipster thing has its pros and cons
fixed
in the real messenger world. But let me get Hadari into it. He's old school. And, you know, just tell us a little bit about your history in the courier industry. You know, when did you get started?
Well, I rookied out in October of 92. I was dating this chick that went to, yes, I'm that old, sweetie. You in the back. You look shocked when I said 92.
All right.
I rookied out in October of 92. How I got into the industry was I was dating this chick that went to Vassar, and her roommate. What? It's a true story, man. She
you was dating a young lady that went to Vassar.
You mind not correcting me? And can I be me?
Go ahead.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Her roommate was dating this messenger dude, and me and him took Metro home north one day, and we got to talking. They were about to close my welfare case, and I needed a job. So he told me, yo, come out to my house in East Orange, New Jersey. I'll give you a bike, a bag, and a lock. And he told me go to 17 Vestry Street to the penthouse to where Breakaway used to be. And I met Dr. Evil there, and yeah, Dr. Evil, Rob Koch. And and here I am.
Okay, so
a lot has happened since then.
You've been mentioned. You went to some of the different cities, right?
Go ahead. I know what I've done.
All right.
Okay. Since then, I've kind of been a little bit of an ambassador for my city here and the messengers here, traveling around the world, traveling around America, North America. Competing in 2005, I won the Cargo Bike World Championship. I helped start the New York Bike Messenger Association. I was the first president of the New York Bike Messenger Foundation, which did the Cycle Messenger World Championships here in New York.
Remember that?
Yeah, you're welcome.
That was fun.
You're welcome.
Good times.
Yeah, thank Ben too.
Thank you, Ben.
And
pleasure.
And, since then, I started my own company back in 99. Now it's folded. I've helped design software for dispatching and customer service. If you own a Belinky crate bike that was made after 2003, that bike is a signature model that's me because they built that bike around my R&D.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Is your name on it?
No, unfortunately, but the championship rings that they've put on there since 2005, those are mine.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah. Currently I'm working at kind of like where I kind of started early on. I work in the customer service department at A to Z Couriers, which was bought out by American Expeditors. And I'm still here.
Oh, well, tell me about, you've seen like Mosh Track and some of the other alley cats, when there was no brand sponsorships, how do you see that transition from brands coming into urban cycling?
I remember back in the day, like we'd go to like the bike shops and ask them to like, give us old dead stock to give away. So, you ride a track bike, but you'd get like mountain bike tires and tubes for your prize. You got to go figure it out, go work it out. It went from going to the bike shops and trying to convince them that this would be good for business and exposure to, and not only doing that, but also coming out your own pocket because, you want people to come to your race and you want them to, go home with nice prizes and stuff. And the funny thing is you go to like these road races in Central Park and Prospect Park and you go to an alley cat. We have better prizes. I don't know if anybody realizes that. Like, you go to a race in Prospect Park, you might get a little medal. If you win, you go to an alley cat race, you get a bike. You get a custom $300, $400 bag. We have much better prizes.
The risks are just bigger in the alley cat race.
Huh?
The risks are much bigger.
The risks are much bigger. So, the prizes are better. It's really grown. I remember the first alley cat I went to, there was about maybe 30 riders. Now you there's alley cats that people put on their calendars and look forward to. Like, Monster Track is one of them. It's like one of the two biggest ones in North America. The other one being, the Super Bowl in Minneapolis, which happens in the dead of winter. And they always have like 200 people show up to that event. Same thing with Monster Track. CMWC just happened in Melbourne, Australia. I don't know if everybody knows, but Austin won that.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Austin. So, yeah, local guy.
He was also the stunt man for Triple Rush. He was doing all the stunts. Real good biker, man.
Yeah.
You was on a set of Triple Rush, right?
Premium Rush.
Premium Rush, I'm sorry. Yeah. Yeah. Premium Rush, right. Premium Rush.
Well, he did Triple Rush and Premium Rush, Austin Horse.
Okay.
Yeah. He did for both.
He did for both. Okay.
Yeah.
Right, right.
And next year it's in Paris. I think I'm going.
Great.
Yeah. Great. I want to go to Paris next year for the World Championships.
Want to go to the championships at Paris?
I haven't been to a World Championship in like 7 years. I'm going to go to Paris next year.
Unbelievable.
I know people there because I know messengers there.
Nice. Yeah.
No, it's funny. I went to Paris. It's funny when you travel abroad, you know, like I went to Paris a couple of years ago on vacation for 2 weeks, and I'm walking along the River Seine, and I see a bike that looked familiar, you know, just how it looked. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, so I was like, fuck it, I'm going to wait for the dude to come out. So a guy comes out, and, you know, I'm like, you're a messenger? He's like, what? You know, he didn't quite, you know, or actually he was just being rude in French and didn't want to say that he spoke English to, like, communicate with me until I showed him my ankle tattoos and he saw that I was a messenger. Then all of a sudden, you know, everything was warm and loving. You know, we had lunch. Yeah.
Great. So we mentioned premium rice. So Jose Morales, he's a longtime messenger, and I'm actually helping Jose on his book project, The Messenger Game. So, Jose, tell me just a little bit about Premium Rush. What was that like?
Premium Rush was very nice. I got the pleasure to work in the movie on behalf of Squid, who gave out the notice. There's a casting call. You have to go down Canal Street. You got to dress as a messenger and look good and don't look sloppy. And then you had the director that came there. And if he liked you, he gave you a number. And then after that, he give you a phone number. You call this number if you're available. And from there on, and then we was cast on the first two shoot, which the main shoot was on East 5th Street and Avenue B. It was like a bar, made it into like a house where they guy says, "Oh, I just won the race. Here are my buddies, we're drinking beer, and it's all fun." And the whole idea is, you know, you gotta go to this event and make sure that if you guys saw the movie, the whole idea is about being this lady being released. And it was fun. I mean, it was interesting.
The movie was horrible.
I mean, if he was an extra like I were, it was a good experience.
So tell me about your book project, The Messenger Game.
The Messenger Game, which to help here with Kirk, I'm like the young man over there says about photojournalism. I'm a photographer by trade. Actually, I had the pleasure to go to Center for the Media Art in Midtown. It was one of my things, I mean, besides liking radio broadcasting, it just so happened that photojournalism came first. And then I said, let me take it one step further. And then I became a photographer. I've worked for most of the local paper, and especially in the Spanish media. And then at the same time, incorporated biking with photography, and also doing a kind of a little bodybuilding photo shoot in the process. And got into the business. I even picked up my own corner in Midtown, 34th Street and 6th Avenue, and start taking pictures over there, and was one of the top photographers for Urban Cyclists Worldwide. Taking pictures of different messenger, different situation, and then I said, I think we had to put some together.
You gonna take my picture when we leave?
And just like most people will say, if I haven't taken a picture, it's because you haven't been a messenger. Or you probably haven't come out somewhere on 34th Street and Soho, because if I haven't taken your picture, no matter how you're trying to run away, I bring my heavy artillery and I get you no matter what.
I actually have a picture that this man took of me hanging on my wall in my house.
And
it's true.
When they started, actually, I think it was either thing that during the Giuliani era or the Bloomberg era, they start fixing Times Square so no traffic would have come through Broadway. Then I got into the messenger business, and
Times Square with that walking thing.
When they started blocking it, they put a fence over there,
it's
and I say
business though. Yeah. I mean,
this is the kind of thing, like especially on 34th Street, when you're trying to take a picture of someone, and some people kind of get them in your front, and sort of like, as a photographer, it's kind of piss you off. So I said, let me go and get a spot where if I want to take a picture of somebody or someone, nobody will block me. So it became like 34th Street and 6th Avenue in Harvard Square became a permanent corner, and I did about 4,000 shots, especially in that particular corner.
Now, did all the messengers know you were taking a picture, or some didn't know?
No, nope. Some of them didn't know. I saw it on an Urban Cyclist Worldwide.
That's interesting.
Actually, some of them didn't know because, one, I did not use the flash, and two, I used a zoom lens.
And so second, I'm trying to stay alive and concentrating on what's in front of us, not the guy taking pictures.
Wow.
and another thing, I put the camera, since I, you know how to use the equipment, put the camera in auto speed. So whatever you do, whether you were eating a banana or you were eating an orange or you're trying to hide from me like somebody did, it didn't work because one guy was coming up from 34th Street and 6th Avenue in the middle of the rush hour and he went like this all the way down. So, okay, you can't be riding like this all day. And when as soon as he came,
Got the picture.
Wow. And ever since then, put some pictures together, being, you know, photo being everywhere. I mean, Kirk did some photos in the books, and, you know, with his help, I started naming the book The Messenger Game, and wrote a story about how to be a messenger, and seeing the good and the bad, seeing a lot of people getting killed, a lot of people getting hurt. I have got hurt myself. And, you know, other than that, like the gentleman says here, we work for different company, but it's still one branch. We help each other out, no matter what it is. It's just like when they mention, officer down. It's the same thing with us. Messenger down.
Messenger down.
I remember one time there was a problem at 50 Rock. And at that time we had the open frequency. And we heard about messenger beef on Rockefeller Center. By the time you know, there's like 50 messenger right there. Well, what's the problem? And we had the same thing on 20th Street. I think a Korean store over there that trying to beat up a guy, or he'd say something about Rob. And by the time you know it, when we got there, the guy changed his whole story around. It's like Messenger Unites.
Me personally, I know four messengers in the 17 years I've been in America. I know four that died. How many you know, Hadari? You actually used to be when Messenger died. You used to help out, right?
Yeah, I'm the one that was me.
Yeah, and
in 1994, the first guy was Bo. His cat used to work with me at A to Z. He got killed right in front of 437 Madison, and at that point, you know, it was me and Rocket, another Rocket. And some other kids that, you know, I don't know if you remember 88 Pete?
Yeah.
Me, 88, Rocket, we kind of, and this kid Kwame, we met up one day. We kind of were finishing up our day in that part of the neighborhood. And for some reason, I don't remember why, I had a can of spray paint in my bag.
We used to tag up back then.
No, I wasn't one of those messengers, because then that made it. That's why we have messenger centers and escorts now, and I don't contribute to that.
Amen.
So I was just like, hey, you know what? We write something on the sidewalk on the street here where he died in the spot, and so you know we kind of blocked the bus lane up, you know, messed up traffic south of 48th Street. You know, a traffic cop came out, you know, and I guess she was the one that was on duty that day, and she saw what we were doing, and she was just like, let me go grab y'all some cones. And then from there, like the 3-4 of us that were there, we were kind of like, yo, man, you know, it's like early on in the week. And I was like, let's go, and everybody that you see in the messenger centers and everything, just spread the word. We're having a memorial rally for this guy. Everybody kind of knows, and, you know, word spreads fast. You know, people get called up. Yo, somebody got hit. You know, next thing you know, people come down. So it was like, yo, let's
just
spread the word.
You find out.
Yeah.
Everybody knows.
Let's spread the word. Let's have a, like, you know, a little memorial get together for the guy. And, you know, we come out, flowers, you know, like we've done. And, you know, that was the very first one. And I got arrested. me, Joey Falasca, you know Kamikaze, right? You remember Kamikaze, right. Joey Falasca from Dugao? Me, him, Kwame, some kids from that printing place that used to be on 55th and 9th.
Right.
Yeah, we got arrested and, you know, and there started my political career as being a political messenger. You know, after that, anytime there was a demonstration or a rally, you know, and the cops would show up, you know, who's in charge? And I'd have 100 fingers pointed at me. So I'd have to go and speak up, which was cool because, you know, after a while, the cops would realize that it was me and I'd be on a chill basis with them. Like that one captain with the catcher's mitts for hands.
You know what? But people don't understand. Cops got to meet their quotas. So you know who they aim at? They aim at the bike messenger. They'll find anything. You don't have a bail ticket.
It's not even.
I don't think what he's saying is geared towards that. I think what he's saying is like, well, in your age, you know, I mean, you guys started that. Like now, I mean, a friend of ours committed suicide, and we put together a ride and these ghost bikes. I don't know if you guys had ghost bikes. If that was in your car, if you guys started that, you know what I mean. But like, they do mess with
that TA thing.
They do mess with us to a certain degree, but I mean, the way it is now, you know what I mean? Like, we have to be aware. Like, I'm not going to jail it's not happening because it's not happening. You know what I mean? Because I run red lights or because I'm not paying the tickets or because I'm going to be aware. Like, I know what I'm getting myself into, and with the city bikes being incorporated with just people commuting to work, you know what I mean? There's way more cyclists on the roads right now. You know what I mean?
It's a totally very true. Different there's, game. There's more cyclists, but
you
there's...
You know, and the way in which we do the same thing. We
you know
do,
what?
And you guys
in
did start,
actuality, but
I'm not anti-police.
If you look at it now, there's
I'm
more...
I'm not anti-police, but I'm
you
saying...
Know? And like, I don't feel like they're out to get us either.
Cops go after people.
They
my
do.
Guys
you know what?
Caught out for sure.
To me, you know what? The
guys
cops...
I got guys
if you go and you're an asshole to a cop, the cop's going to write you up and lock you up. If you're cool about it and you have a rapport with them...
Listen,
yeah, but that's because they asked for it, dude.
You're gonna get
that's
a ticket
because
for
they asked for it.
Not a helmet, not having a light.
But, I've talked my way out of many of those tickets,
right.
Man, because I know how to be nice.
And all that.
Yeah.
But like
where was I?
Yeah,
y'all threw me off.
Yeah, I got
when
Alex
had,
going.
When I had the pleasure to work for Mobile, and every time there was like an event or a rally, the finger was being pointed at me because for some reason, without checking, oh, he did it. You ain't supposed to do this here. You ain't supposed to do that there. So in another word, it's like I'm a promoter for the whatever event, letting people know. And, you know what?
You
get
you know what we have not
penalized for
we
something.
Not touched on the bike lane.
Oh,
when I was in
oh,
the
dude,
business.
We're just getting
bike
started
bike
with rallies, man.
Safest,
bike lanes don't come for a couple of years.
Safest place to ride your bike, especially when you ride fast.
In the middle of traffic.
Right in the middle. You're riding on the white. You're riding on the
days.
White. You're
that's
riding on the white
place,
spots.
Yeah.
You're riding that. And you make traffic adjust to you. And you are, that's the safest place to be. This bike lane
bike lanes
thing,
are death.
You want to own a city bike? You want to get on the bike lane? You have to because cops make it sometimes. No problem. But you know why? It doesn't stop the cabs from turning left on
you. Just cut, you know,
it doesn't stop
was,
delivery
and,
men
and
from
that was in that position too.
Cutting in front of you so they could get a parking. It's not going to stop.
Yeah.
So I still ride in the middle. I still ride in the middle. I roll up here in the middle.
I would say, you guys, I'm going to be saving about 20 minutes for questions and answers. So I have one more panelist. And you know what? Go ahead. Shoot your question.
Related.
You shoot your question.
It's kind of related because I wondered in the poem you wrote, Kurt.
Yes.
It's called The Tech Invasion.
Yes.
Where were you going with that? Were you saying something about these new apps?
But those, each of those companies in those poems have created apps. So I currently work for Uber, right? Uber created an app for messenger work. So it's a technology, and these big tech companies, eBay, Amazon, they're very much interested in the courier industry. And they're creating apps for us to be couriers to use. And their computer software where there's really no dispatcher. The computer kind of controls everything. So it's very interesting. So in that poem, The Tech Invasion, I got recruited about a couple of years ago to get involved with some of these companies, and I left my old company to take a chance with eBay, and I became like the first courier with eBay. eBay paid us twice as much as regular courier work. I mean, up to a grand a week. So it was good money that, you know, I really needed. But that's where I'm going with that poem. So I think Alex is up next, and this is a good segue into Alex, because Alex, he's been working with these apps. He's know a little bit about it. So, you know, talk a little bit about, you know, your experiences with these tech companies, Uber, Zimmits, other ones you work with. And you even got his own company now. So
yeah. When I first started, I started as a walking messenger, actually. I'm not a native New Yorker. I'm from Georgia. I was working with a temp agency. I lost my job at the temp agency due to, I was boxing. Temp agency. I was working temp to perm job. I was boxing at the time. It was April and it was supposed to be warm. I left from the gym, no jacket, no anything. And it was cold outside. I got home. My throat was acting up. I woke up next morning, felt bad. Second day happened, still was at home, stayed home. Okay, went back into temp agency. I was like, okay, I want to go back to this temp to perm thing. And it didn't work out. I was like, no, we replaced you. Okay, cool, fine. So temp agency has other jobs. So I'm there 5, 6 a.m. They didn't send me out. I went and got the paper. I was living in Jersey City at the time. We got the paper, and I was looking in the back of it. And what they had there was said messenger. It said messenger. And just walking, I was like, I could do that. I was like, cool. So I went there. Max Mail, I went there, and the guy was like, nope, we're not hiring. Come back in 6 months. So same thing happened next morning. I went to the temp agency 5, 6 a.m. They didn't send me out. I went back, got the paper, looking for a job. And that same ad was in there. I went back to that guy. I was like, man. And he's like, I told you yesterday, come back in 6 months. And I'm like, man, the ad is in the paper, bro. Like, can you, like, help me? I want to work. You know what I mean? I can do this. He's like, you know what? Come back at 10 a.m. Came back at 10 a.m. There's like 20 people in there. You know, I ended up signing up. I was getting paid 45 cents per package. And they like, you know those gelato trucks where they shoot, like, the ice cream and whatnot? We filled those up with packages. And I would walk from 263 West 38th Street up to, like, 90th and York Avenue. And when I emptied out, I would have to go back down and re-up again. I would have to go get more packages just in order for me to, like, make ends meet so I can have money. You know, and they saw that I was hungry. They ended up putting me on a route downtown. I was getting paid by the hour. I think minimum wage at the time was $7.50. So they put me $7.50. And I would walk from two, and they gave me $5 for a MetroCard. I would walk around with like a little cart. The $5 was supposed to be for the MetroCard, but I could walk it and get there. So I would walk it. That was my lunch money. And I got to know the route downtown. So I would do that. And one day I was at Four New York Plaza, and this kid came in. He has a helmet on, the bag and everything. I'm like, it's like, can you do this on a bike? He's like, yeah, I'm a bike messenger, bro. I was like, really? Like, what the fuck? This is a thing? Like, I didn't even know. I rode my bike to, again, I was living in Jersey City. So I was riding my bike to Journal Square, locking it up, getting on the train, going to 38th Street and coming back, you know? And I ended up going to Champion. That's where this kid worked at. And I went there, they gave me like a 5-question test, like, where's like Chase Manhattan Plaza, where's 550 Madison Avenue, and I aced it. Boom, you're hired. So I got on the bike, and I'm like, yo, it's not like I have a job. I'm just like riding, dude. Because that's what I would do on the weekend. On the weekend, I would just come over here and just ride. And I got to know the city, but I became unhappy with my pay. I mean, I was busting out 20. As a matter of fact, that same day I got hired there, I got hired as a food delivery guy because this girl, my bike was stolen from Journal Square. And this girl I was dealing with at the time, she gave me her bike because I was rode bikes my whole life. She gave me her bike and it was a Magna. And I'm like, man, I can't do this, man. I'm going to steal a bike right now, straight up. And I walk from 38th Street again downtown because those guys downtown, the food, they leave their bikes unlocked just because of the neighborhood that it's in. Wow. And I dismissed the idea on like 28th Street. And so I went down anyways. I got hired. I stopped on between Hudson, on Hudson between 10th and Charles. And they said, deliver. I said, shoot, I could do that. I went in there. The manager wouldn't be there. And as I dismissed the job, I went inside of there. I was like, oh, well, you're hiring? She's like, the manager's not here. The manager's not here. Come back in 30 minutes. I'm like, cool. So I left. And as I'm walking again down Hudson at Christopher Street, there's a delivery guy coming up
Christopher Street on his bike with a bike in tow. And I'm like, bro, I'm like, look, what do you want for this bike? What do you want? Like, what do you want for this bike? He's like, man, it's messed up. Like, you can have it. He gave me the bike. He gave me back, went back, got hired that same day. And I became unhappy working at Champion because I was working 25, 30 runs a day. And the highest check I ever saw from them was $353.63. And I'm like, $353? Like, what the fuck is this? And Instagram had just, excuse my language, you guys. Instagram had just came out, and there's this guy, his name is Kid. Well, we call him Kid, Fernando Rivera. And I was following him on Instagram. And I was at 519 8th Avenue. I was coming out, and I saw him. I was like, yo, I follow you on Instagram, man. I was like, I see your guys, like, the guys in the street, you street kings, like, you guys seem like everybody's happy over there. It's like, man, how is it over there? Not knowing he owned the company. He's like, you know, you come there on a Wednesday or Friday, and you come holler at me. I was like, all right, cool. I went there, and he hired me. I was 2 years into me working as a messenger, and I knew nothing about, I'd never been to a messenger party. I never knew anything about a subculture. I was just doing it for the money, straight up. And then that's where I found out about that. And from there, that took me into dispatching for Dutch Express when they merged clients. And the owner of Dutch Express, Marcus told me he couldn't afford me. I worked for him for like 3 weeks. He said he couldn't afford me. And at the time I was trying to start my own business. It became an idea when I was working for Champion, just because I was like, man, I can make so much more money, but I didn't know how to get the client. You know, and Marcus let me go. And to get into your question, that and within that same week that Marcus let me go, a friend of mine named Ninja told me a week prior, it was like, yo, Uber is hiring.
Ninja works for me.
They're paying $25 an hour. You should go there and sign up. Yeah. And
Uber Technology, that's the cab service.
Yeah. And that week before, like, I didn't have the time because my time at Dutch Express to dispatch was between 2 and 7, and you had to go there between 2 and 6. But when he let me go on that Thursday, I went there Friday and got hired by Uber West. We were beta testers, $25 an hour. And there's no work. Nobody knows about this or anything. Yeah. So I'm getting paid $25 an hour essentially just to sit down. You know, but the way Uber's technology works, it's like whoever's the closest to you in the vicinity, their job is dispatched to you. So you get, like, it doesn't matter who's there, but that's that. Zipmans, during the course of the time that I was working at Street Kings, Postmates came from San Francisco to New York. And what Postmates does,
Postmates is another app.
Postmates focuses mostly on food delivery, but what they also do is you have buying power. You have a PEX card, what they call it. You have a PEX card, and you can go, if you wanted a Monopoly game, and you just have friends over, and you wanted Monopoly, Jenga, Cranium, Apples and Apples, and Scrabble to add to your party, you can go log on to Postmates, put your order in, and someone accepts it, you pay a delivery fee, and they can buy the Scrabble, the Apple, the Monopoly, Jenga, and Cranium, and bring it to you all within an hour.
Okay, that's beautiful, because I didn't understand where you were going with the poem. I didn't. So in other words, when you said they really are putting money in your pocket, I didn't know if you were being, you know, facetious or if it were true. Now I know it's true.
No, they're putting money in your pocket.
They were, and they are.
There's something about messengers. We all hard workers, man.
For sure.
There's something they cannot take that away from nobody here.
You got to give it to the clients.
But the rich people want it. The rich people want it. Yeah. So when I'm delivering a cake for $25,
I mean, you're paying
just a cake.
You're paying a 9% delivery. Like, the overall total, you're paying 9%. That's just a service charge in addition to the delivery fee. And if you want a tip. So if it's cost $50 for your order just initially, if your item costs $50, 9% of that is almost, what, $10? Almost $5, so $4.50. In addition to the delivery fee, which may range anywhere between $4 to like $18. So you end up paying like $75. And if you're a nice person, you end up paying $80 for this $50 board game. Wow. But that's when it started, like, with generating cash. And when Uber came around, I was like, man, it is possible. All these ideas that I have in my head, is possible for me to make $25 an hour just based upon the work that I put into this.
I get, because Postmates could be like any commodity, any
right.
But Uber,
it's like, if you were to leave your keys at a friend's house and you didn't have the time to go get your keys, you can log into the Uber application, and if there's a messenger close by, tell, and as soon as he accepts that job, like, hey, you're going to pick up keys from 435 Hudson, and we're bringing it to 226 West 38th Street.
Yeah.
And it'll be to you again with under an hour.
Right, right. It's fast service, you know, for instead of a corporation using it, they're giving it to you, a consumer. And, so anybody can use it. They can get a fast messenger. So it's National Poetry Month, and Alex is a poet. So can you kick one of your poems for us?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we are
a little bit... Yeah, you've got some time. Yeah.
No, I wanted to continue before... I mean, even before that, I don't know. Even before that, like Kurt said, I own a messenger company now.
Yeah.
You know, and Uber, it gave me that push, like, oh, this is possible. Like, we can do it, and push the envelope and set it there to where we... The messenger, the person that's going around doing this work, you're being compensated for it. Not doing $175 jobs a week, getting paid $353. That doesn't make any sense.
Because in the city, the origin of the job, I want an Xbox right now. Yeah. I call the messenger company. I speak to maybe. Who's that? I might speak to like a dispatcher, and I tell him I want an Xbox, and I want it from here, and I live here. Then that dispatcher calls the messenger and says, "Yo, I got a pickup for you, blah blah blah," and pick up that Xbox and bring it here. So now that's a lot of people that has to get paid: the messenger company, the dispatcher, and the courier, and the other two jobs that the courier has in his back. And if he's not good at his job, he probably messes up jobs, and then. Now, certain people don't get paid. Some people do get paid, and now the dispatcher's mad at you because you're not getting him paid. You
know, right, and at the end of the day, the person that's executing the work is the one that is suffering, you know? Yeah. And for me, like, I mean, from working at Max Mail, from working at Champion, working with Street Kings, when I was working with Uber, these people, like, the companies were starting to use, they're using Uber. And the personal relationships that I developed throughout the time, was like, you guys are using this? Like, really? So, you know what? I had a promo code. 5 free deliveries. Like, you know what? Next time you need something, you call me first. Because the way Uber's technology works, it's like the closest person in the vicinity is going to get that job. So if the pickup is at 248 West 48, 25th Street, and I'm standing in front of 248 West 25th Street, that job is going to come to me. You know, so I use that to my advantage and just branched out from there. You know?
So we only have a few.
Yeah, like, for sure.
No, but let me get that poem in there. And then,
well, I'll say one of them now. I'll say one now. Maybe later the other one.
Yeah,
I mean, honestly, this, I feel like, I got you, B. I got you. You know, even for us and how, like, he talks about the 80s, he mentioned the 90s, and how people look at you. Like, even now, in 2015, people look at us like, oh, well, this is just a messenger dude. Like, just because my dress... You know, or like how I look. You know what I mean? People are, they're being judgmental on you. They don't know any layers to this person. Yeah, like, this is a good thing that Cordell is doing with his messenger study. Okay? So, like, the messenger study, if you guys have Instagram, follow him. Instagram, Stay Alive NYC, and you can figure that stuff out. But this is just the way I was feeling, and this is even prior to becoming a messenger when I wrote this. But my persona, on a good day, doesn't match the things that I say. My jeans and my tee to society doesn't match being intellectually inclined, but defined as one that has been left behind. Over time, I've seen both sides of the coin laying on either by being judged as soft because of my demeanor. But as far as I've traveled and long as I've gone, I've let people know this is the shit that I'm on. Being me is a blessing I would never undo, regardless of people's opinions or their description of the truth. So I continue on my path, and any potential obstacle that's in my way, I'm sure to go right past. Because I'm me, and ain't no changing that. So I ask, why have I said all this? Because you're encountering this when you are the shit. Have confidence and be one to persist. And that's that.
Any more questions? Oh, it's a question over here.
Yeah. Has anyone heard of a writer called Charles Wright?
No, I don't know.
African-American writers.
Yeah,
I heard of him. Outside of St. Louis. Yeah, he was a writer. His first book was published in the mid-60s, and it was called The Messenger. And it was about being a messenger in New York in like the 50s and 60s, and he kind of used the job also to explore the whole city. And he was, you know, acclaimed by like James Baldwin and other writers. He ended up writing for the Village Voice, wrote a couple of other books, and you know, but Just wonder if anyone knew about that, because that's also, because, you know, I look at the thing, I'm a native New Yorker, I look at his books, and I also see the older New York how things have changed and everything. I was also wondering if anyone had thought about using, you know, this the let's call it like the messenger position to really analyze like sort of what's going on in the city, because he used his book to like go from top to bottom, so you can see like all these interactions in New York, including interactions that New Yorkers, you know, deny. Okay. He's Afro-American.
We messengers always get a, like a bad rap, and just because we like, we messengers, they think that just because they ride a bike, for a living, they're not smart.
Exactly, or on drugs, or a convicted felon, or like some of these things are true about some of us on this panel.
There's a lot of messengers, you know, who are felons.
Yeah, it's true.
You got to keep it real. Yeah.
No,
you know what?
For sure.
And it's because it's the only thing that society will allow them to do when they get out of jail. And it's kind of, it, right. You know, it's not funny.
You
it's kind
of
sad,
man. You hit it right on the top of the head.
And yeah, unfortunately, though, like, because now I'm actually working at a big company and seeing how they exploit, like, guys that are coming out of jail. First of all, they treat them like shit. They yell at them, and it's kind of like, you know, that, you know, sometimes dispatchers, I find, well, in my company at least, well, actually what I've seen in the industry overall is, you know, dispatchers seem to take this like correctional officer stance on how they treat their people in the field.
You know what?
I'm not done.
That sucks.
And you know, and like I've worked at companies where that doesn't happen, like. And I'll say it right now, for the record, the best company that I ever worked at was at Elite Couriers, and it was because the dispatchers, the owners, the guy on the phone troubleshooting treated you with respect. No matter how bad you messed up, he wouldn't flip on you, and it'd be like, okay, let's fix this. Rather than you getting cursed out and hung up on and nothing gets fixed or it takes a long time, it's like,
the best all right,
cool, let's do
ex-bikers.
This. Let's.
The best dispatchers are ex-bikers.
What
and
he
I
said.
Could say that, I could say that proudly. Now, you know what? I'm also going to say this. We get a bad rap. I was able to do something in 2011 that gave us a different look, gave people a different look about messengers. Okay? Back in Brooklyn in 2011, there was a lot of sexual attacks in Park Slope, Windsor Terrace, and Sunset Park. There were like 50 attacks. Every night, somebody was getting groped. Or it was an attempted rape. I came up with an idea, walking people home. People call me 45 minutes before they get out of their train. And we started walking women home every single day from 2011. And we just stopped recently in April. This past week, in the beginning of April, we just stopped. For 3.25 years, we walked people home to get them home safe. Police knew what we was doing. We never got in. We was not officially endorsed by the police. But and they used to, you know, I used to go around in community centers and tell people about my service. Yeah. All we did was walk people home. We did it for free.
Yeah, but we're not all bad guys. You know what I mean?
I was on a mission. I was on a personal mission because I saw a woman get attacked and no one came to her aid. I am proud to say that I am the only messenger in the history of messengers that will ever win a Humanitarian Man of the Year award. It was given to me by the New York City Transit Authority this past November. And every time people found out that I was a former messenger, it was like, wow. And I was like, listen, you know, we got brains too. We might be a little rough. And I've probably been one of the loudest people on this panel. And you would never imagine that I'm the current Humanitarian Man of the Year. Okay? And I don't think it's a big deal, because I was like on a, you know, it was like a mission from God. We just wanted to walk people home and stop the craziness. You know, they judge messengers in the wrong way. You hear this man, he just said a nice, beautiful poem. Kurt too. Everybody here got something to offer. All messengers do. At my job now, I'm a dispatcher now. I train my guys to be good, not just to be fast and get the work done. I train them to be good. I train you to do it the right way. And And you know what? And some people think that working as a messenger is a dead-end job. Not if you don't want it to be.
If you know where you're going.
If you know where you're going,
he's saying skyscraper.
It's not a dead-end job. It's not.
Like skyscraper.
This is my craft. There are many buildings. This is what I do. I'll be a mess until I die. I tell people that at dinner parties.
Yeah,
I don't care.
Wow.
I've hung out with millionaires who are CEOs of Fortune 500 companies on beaches in the Caribbean. They ask me what I do, and I proudly say I'm a New York City bike messenger.
Wow.
This is my trade craft. This is what I do. This is my career. This is not my job.
My career.
End of story.
So to ask you a question, I've written like about 10 books, not all of them on the messenger experience, but what I tend to write about is like Charles Wright came from a different generation, and my story is kind of infuse a lot of urban culture. So I come from a generation that, I'll put it simple, I grew up around a lot of black-on-black crime and drugs. So it's a little different than, say, maybe Langston Hughes or Charles Wright. So in my messenger stories, the messengers, the thing about why messengers are so popular and why people are attracted to them is that there are authentic characters. We work in the streets. We're not faking it. We're not rappers faking the streets. We work in it. We know it. We live it.
Like literally,
so,
too.
So
I know.
So I take that grit that, you know, I get as a messenger, and I try to write about it and write about the city from a messenger angle and speaking truth to power. So I try not to hide a lot of stuff.
I guess I wasn't unclear. I mean, because Charles Wright himself was also, you know, I mean, he was a messenger and also, you know, like
you said in the 60s,
a
right?
Writer.
Yeah, he's a good writer.
Yeah, so, yeah, I'm just, you know, is I just saying, you know, in terms of like providing a historical context as well into the way, you know, your job has developed over time, the way New York has developed over.
I'd say this, like speaking now, being living, breathing messenger, you know, I mean, a lot of these kids that are doing it now, they're not doing it. I mean, I got this strictly for the job. Again, I didn't get to the subculture until 2 years into it. But she was able to look up via online because she met certain people that were involved with the subculture. And these kids are getting on carbon fiber bikes.
Just to be part of
it. Just to be part of it. Not know how to ride them or do anything risking putting their lives at risk just to be cool. You know what I mean? That's where this is being geared towards now. It's being geared towards like big business.
Well,
it's cool for me to have this messenger bag on with this pouch and these certain type of shoes, these clipless shoes, and this type of bike. And you don't even know how to ride it, bro.
It's a style.
You
know, it used to be. I'm sorry, guys.
It's just not like that anymore. These, I mean, granted, you know what I mean? Like, they come from a different place, and I respect it entirely. But we're living in a totally different world.
Right.
Yeah, straight up.
Right. I think.
I guess because, you know, like with Charles Wright, like, you know, because of his experiences, he also saw our reality in a different way. Like, I pretty much can tell that you all see it in a certain way. And sometimes he's very, like, bitter. Sometimes he's, like, screamingly funny and ironic.
60s was crazy.
So I wonder
if he was on a horse instead of a bike.
He might have been a walker.
So I was just wondering, you know, if you all had come across his work and you know, maybe she'd
check it out.
It's noted.
Sounds interesting. Yeah.
I just want to say, like, something that I've seen that's changed in the industry is, like, a couple of years ago I was at Monster Track. And, like, you know, I'm walking around and, you know, I'm kind of being looked at as, like, you know, the old man there. And, like, you know, I'm just listening to people to try and figure out, like, who they are and, you know, what they're doing there. And, you know, and the definition of, like, calling yourself a bike messenger now is way different than what it used to be. Like, you know, I heard kids there, like, you know, get out. Talking about, oh, yeah, man, I worked really hard. I did 2 shifts this week at the burrito place. You know, it's like, how do you pay your rent? How do you pay your rent? You know, and just things like that. Oh, I hope I can work. It's like, you know, you need to go and, like, get you a real messenger job.
You'll never see a
bike
messenger.
Or to
the hell you can't.
It's been
And so how you know, that really shocked me because, like, you know, cats that are, you know, like, older that, you know, came out like, you know, in the early 90s to like mid to late 90s, you know, it's all about like, you know, you work a full day. You get out there at 8, you work till 6, and you just bust it out, rain, sleet, or snow. And, you know, now it's, you know, I'll see if I, yeah, if it's nice out, I'll go deliver sandwiches and like call myself a messenger.
For
because
sure.
I ride a track bike, you know, and I wear skinny
like
jeans.
Somehow it's been glorified. Like from where you guys are talking, like somehow it's been glorified.
And, but, Hold on, let me get to my point. You know, the excuses that I hear every single day
when it's raining. Think about that.
It's 8 o'clock, guys. We
I'm sorry, I was about to say something smart.
Yeah.
You know, and how I make the analogy between bike messengers and alley cats now, you know, and the way that the industry's going is kind of like the way like the ranching industry went with cowboys, where the alley cat now can be equivocated to the rodeo, where it's just a skill competition, where there's not really any cowboys out here riding around delivering packages. It's just, you know, people that are, you know,
buy
this
it
is,
in
this
American
is,
apparel.
This is their hop. Thank you.
You can go
yes,
buy it at
You can
Chrome.
Go get your little you chewing go- gum. You can go get your chewing gum Levi's and have the look, you know. And,
So it's changed. So
yeah.
It's changed. It's a culture
it's
that
changed. I was
people
about to
share.
Say that
and
answer.
Yeah,
myself.
Go ahead. No, I'm just saying we want to wrap it up. But go.
Yeah, and you know, so to me, that's a very dramatic change that's happened in the industry where the you know the workforce is very you know minimalist you know standard bearers. I'm done.
Thank God.
So.
Well, you know, I was trying to make that
to finish out. I have my one of my sponsors is Audley, and I have a bag to raffle off. So if you guys, the pro guys, I'm trying not to give the bag, but it's not that many of us here, so maybe that's what it is. So who did fill? Did everybody fill out one? Fill out one. Okay. You fill that one already? How about
the second draw?
I'm just going to. Oh, she filled that one already.
I was the second guy in New York City. That's how old I am.
Anybody else want to?
Yeah, I just think that.
Okay, that's why you made me laugh.
I feel like, you know what I mean? Like, it had this change, bro.
I'm going to take a quick shot before you split.
Oh, I'm not looking. Like, that's mixed up. I'm putting on my bag.
Can I say something? I'm kind of based on I mean, you've been talking a lot about posers and people just getting on the bike and kind of, you know, pretending to be bike messengers. But I think there is also a positive side in that.
Yeah.
Maybe not everybody gets on a track bike, but
yes.
People
sure.
are still influenced. I mean, they see you cool and it's like, oh, I'll just get a bike and
for
just
sure.
ride in the city. So I think it's not as grim as you present, and I think there
I
might
concur.
Be some.
I agree with you 100%.
I think what the
we were trying to get there. Us new age.
I think what the fighting attitude is about is that as a messenger, you feel your wrists hurting, you feel your feet hurting, you know, you feel your back hurting from having that bag grip your shoulders. And when you get home at night, it's like, man.
And your body has the shakes, and
you
have to sleep with
you
your legs.
You go to sleep,
elevated.
And you wake up, and you do it again. So when you see someone that you believe to be
you know
a poster, it's like, you know, it's like,
hey, there's no glory in this. There's no glory in it, and that's,
true.
You know what I mean? Like I like that City Bike has done the things that they have done, and even more people are riding their bikes and just wanting to be like down. There's a kid that I met. His name is Hannington. He's been a Uber messenger for like 2 weeks, and he's just like, oh man, this is awesome. I want to know more about like this. He came out to Cordell's show last night, and he was just like really gung-ho just to know, but I was like, look, don't get caught up in the hype. Like, if you really appreciate it for what it is. Like, it took me, again, two whole years before I even knew anything about a subculture. I was doing it because just for the love of it, you know? And then when you get into this, like, these guys I respect for sure. You know what I mean? They've had their time. You know what I'm saying? Our time is now, and we're doing with something different. We're dealing with something different. I respect all of them. You know, anybody, even if you're just riding by, like I don't want like there's too many people. There's people
that we didn't deal with.
There's people being hit like on these carbon fiber, these aluminum frames that weigh 5-6 pounds or 12 pounds, 11 pounds, and they don't know how to ride them, and they're risking their lives. They're dying because of that. Last night I was coming into Brooklyn. This kid was on a carbon fiber bike, a felt TK2, going up, going Brooklyn Bound, and his fork broke on him, wearing no helmet, wearing no helmet at all, having this carbon fiber bike, and obviously he didn't know what he was doing on that bicycle at all. He did not. You know what I mean? He just was not prepared. It was raining. He didn't have any rain gear. He didn't have any lights. He didn't have anything. But he had a dope bike. You should see my bike. My bike sucks. You know what I'm saying? It's not the coolest looking bike at all. But it's functional. It's function over form. And I'm keeping myself alive because of it. What we're dealing with now is just an influx of this pop culture being like, I make a reference at Chrome and at this, and you're wearing this stuff trying to be something that you're not. And I would just like take your time. Let yourself develop into that. You know what I mean?
When the weather's nice too.
Yeah, and that too. Like even if you're not coming out on a rain day, like by all means do that. Know your lane. You know what I mean? Like just don't jump into them. Like yeah, I'm just like yeah. And then when we take you out and you're riding with us, you're trying to keep up and you're going to fucking die because you don't know what you're doing.
You know what?
You know what I'm saying? That's what we're dealing with. And actually not even putting a brake on there at all. Like, that sucks. You know what I mean? And lives are being lost. People are getting hurt. Like, the same people that get hit nowadays, they're always getting hit. Like, everybody I know that gets hit by a car, they do it. It happens multiple times. Yeah. Every single time. Like, it's like, oh, he got hit? Oh, again? Really? You know what I mean? But that's just that guy. He obviously doesn't know how to ride the bike that he's on, but if he would just like slow down and take his time,
or
maybe he would
on his bike.
And be able to get to that point. It's just like, dude, we're not just jumping into it. Like, I know about the X-Men. I know about them. I'm not going to sit up here and just grab onto a freaking back of a freaking 18-wheeler going over the Williamsburg Bridge with the cars.
Or a fire truck. Why not?
And not knowing what I'm doing just because I saw him doing it. I was like, yeah, let me just jump on there and do it.
I'd do that on a cargo bike, dude.
No, but see, again, experience. But you didn't, I imagine when you, on your first day in 92, you didn't just go ahead and just like, yo, let me just do this. No.
No, that wasn't until my third day.